know how we come to that collective realization ourselves, but I do believe that churches should be leading us and reminding us that we are one community and we will only find a good future together. So I think, to some extent, that's about making sure that our discourse is kept compassionate. In other ways, I think it is about lifting up the causes of people who have been oppressed and telling their stories as well. I think the church all over the world has done that in good ways. South Africa is another example that comes to mind. But I also think that finding ways for us to be actively politically engaged is something that mainline congregations have backed off from, because there was just an assumption that by teaching people to be good, the right things would happen. And I don't think that that's true. That in the course of American history, even, we can see how churches have become politically involved in things to make the world a better place. In every country I can think of where major conflict has happened, faith communities have been at the forefront of advocating for peace and justice. And I think the more we can do that again as faith communities and step outside our comfort zones where we've sort of sought shelter just for our good and comfortable lives, I think that's part of what we need to learn from communities around the world that have done that.
Well, this week your sermon is based on John chapter 14. Would you read it for us?
Yes. Jesus answered him, "Those who love you will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I am coming to you. If you love me, you would rejoice that I am going to the Father, because the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you this before it occurs, so that when it does occur, you may believe."
Marty, we look forward to hearing your sermon, Connect with Real Life, Connect with Jesus. Thank you for sharing it with us.
I'm glad to.
And if you'd like to listen again to today's program with Hardy Kim with an extended interview, you can subscribe to Day One on your favorite podcast app or listen on our website at dayone.org, where you can also read or share the sermon transcript. If you'd like a free printed sermon transcript, just call us at 404-815-9110.
The lectionary gospel reading for today obscures the true value of Jesus' teaching in addressing this challenge, because it doesn't include the question that prompts Jesus' answer. Now, it's not a particularly good question. Rather, we can notice the contrast between the question and Jesus' answer. Verse 22 reads, Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world? This is a quintessentially inside the church question. Jesus, how are we supposed to be different from the rest of the world? Lord, how are you going to prove